I'd like to ask you, what exactly is our policy towards Cuba? One of your spokesmen has said that communism in this hemisphere is not negotiable. Then what do we do about Castro?
Well, there are two main things that seems to me must be done, and which are in process. One is that we must do everything that we can to ensure that Cuba is not itself exploited as a base for the further penetration of forces and elements from outside the hemisphere into other countries of this hemisphere. That is, any attempt to use Cuba as a base for agents or arms or whatever it is into other countries will require the immediate and energetic attention of all the governments and countries concerned. I think, secondly, that the members of the Organization of American States do, more than ever now, recognize that this is something more than a bilateral question between Cuba and the United States, that it is in fact a problem for the hemisphere, that it is a potential disturbance to the peace of the hemisphere, and that the OAS itself should give it very serious thought and attention. We're developing our diplomacy and our discussions with other governments along both these lines.
Well, this penetration is, however, going on, is it not? I understand that the other day, one day this week, in Montevideo, 5 tons of Mao Zedong's writings on guerrilla warfare were confiscated, and it's thought that they came via Cuban channels to Montevideo.
I think we must recognize in this country that the Sino-Soviet bloc has made a very serious decision that it will try to press its opportunities beyond our alliances, jumping over the alliances, going around the alliances, in order to make as much headway as possible in the so-called underdeveloped parts of the world. Mr. Khrushchev has indicated that his great interest in these parts of the world, and he includes Latin America, in the underdeveloped countries. Since 1954, they have been putting more and more resources into economic and cultural relations. They've been building up their propaganda very rapidly. Now, we believe that they will make an effort, a serious effort, in Latin America with all the propaganda and other resources at their disposal. We feel that the primary protection against this kind of attempted penetration is the mobilization of the energies and interests and the loyalties of the people of Latin America in their own economic and social development. As if that, if the peoples of this hemisphere show that they are on the move along the lines of President Kennedy's Alliance for Progress, if they are ready themselves to take their own futures in their own hands, and can move to build up their own education, their health, their productivity, that this is the way that society has become impervious to this sort of penetration. Now, there are other things in the propaganda field, in the cultural relations, in broadcasting, many things which we can do more strongly than we're now doing. These require funds, and funds are not always easy to come by.
Well, Mr. Secretary, without getting into sort of washing dirty linen on the CIA and the rest of it, have you found that the Central Intelligence Agency's involvement in the Cuban fiasco gave us a black eye pretty well all over the world? Have you found that it dictates policy anyplace else other than it did in Cuba?
I don't think that I want to comment about a specific agency in a specific episode. I'm reminded of a statement made earlier that as far as that particular event was concerned, there was something in it for everybody. No, I think that policy, the present administration, in our foreign policy, is made by the president and the secretary of state.
Well, let me ask you
and his key advisors
another one, and let me quote you. I've got it written down here. Rusk's law. There's been some discussion about whether or not there are two State Departments, one at the White House and one over here in this building and in your office. And you wrote back in Foreign Affairs a year ago that no department or agency can be coordinated by a parallel department or agency. In other words, if you've got two agencies working on the same problem, you never get together. You think that's happening?
Oh, I'm sorry that I have to suggest that as a misquotation. That was a law to which I was objecting in this article. That is, I do not myself take the view that it should be considered infra-dig to defer to a companion agency. Coordination is something which ought to be worked out by the assignment of central responsibilities to identifiable individuals and departments who in turn have the responsibility for coordination with their neighbors.
Well,
and that we do need to work toward a simplification of the arrangements by which we come to our decisions. And I think the present administration has been doing that.
Well, you find no objection to the presidential task force under Adolf Burley or any conflict with the new Assistant Secretary of State, Mr. Woodward?
Now, when the new administration took responsibility on January 20th, there were a great many urgent jobs that had to be done quickly. For example, the book which my colleagues in the department kindly prepared for me, entitled Major Issues Facing the New Administration, was a loose-leaf book, some 3 inches thick. Now, one of the there were several things in the Latin American field which needed to be done promptly. For example, the program under the so-called Bogota program had to be presented to Congress, and quickly, to get that program moving. This could not have been done in the time available through the normal machinery of government. So that task force took that on. The Brazilian financing was a part of it. Some of the steps we've taken in Bolivia is a part of it. So that task force, during this period of getting started, has done some extraordinarily helpful and effective things. Now, as we settle in and we get our new arrangements set, the normal procedures will more and more, of course, take over.
But I think you might agree, sir, that Secretary Dulles was perpetually vigilant to see that there was no great influence on President Eisenhower in the foreign policy field from anybody except him, whether it be from Dr. Milton Eisenhower or Harold Stassen or anyone. Is this something every secretary has to watch out for?
Well, how these procedures work is, of course, a matter of interest to any secretary and to any president. But let me just comment that Washington, to me, is a city which is filled with quiet diplomacy, but a good deal of vocal gossip. President is in full charge of his office and of foreign policy. He has used the Department of State and the other departments as he needs them to help him in this job. There is close and friendly contact between his personal staff and the departments concerned. After all, with the abolition of the old Operations Coordination Board, it would be expected that certain members of his personal staff and the staff of the National Security Council would be more active in the liaison field than before. But let me assure you that this is not a matter which has struck into the actual operations of government in the way that some of the reports would suggest.
Mr. Rusk, are you in favor of secretaries of state traveling a great deal? I understand you've traveled more than Mr. Dulles in an equal period of time.
Well, there were three stated meetings of foreign secretaries that were facing me when I first took office. And I felt that I ought to go to those meetings and get acquainted with my colleagues from other countries. Then there was one unplanned meeting at Geneva over Laos. I still think that the principal post, the habitual post of the Secretary of State, ought to be at his desk in Washington. I have discussed with some of my colleagues among the foreign ministers the problem of organizing a sort of trade union of foreign ministers to create tolerable working conditions for ourselves.
Excuse me, sir. I'm afraid that's all the time we have. On that thought, I would like to thank you very much indeed. We all have a national, nonpartisan interest in wishing you the very best of luck.
Thank you very much, Mr. Smith.
This has been an informal and spontaneous discussion with the Secretary of State, Dean Rusk, and originated at the source, in the office of the Secretary at the State Department in the nation's capital. Secretary Rusk was questioned by Chief CBS News Washington correspondent Howard K. Smith and CBS News correspondents Bill Downs and Paul Niven. For a printed copy of this program, the views of the Secretary of State on current world developments, send a stamped, self-addressed envelope and 10 cents to At the Source, Post Office Box 200, Washington 4, D.C. We invite you to join us 4 weeks from tonight when we will be At the Source, for another news interview with a prominent world figure. At the Source was produced by Michael J. Marlowe. Assistant to the producer, Louise Remy. Directed by Bill Linden. Technical director, Harry Remmers. Jamie Bragg speaking. At the Source, pre-recorded on videotape, has been a public affairs presentation of CBS News.
This is the CBS Television Network.